everyone. Welcome back. My name is Dandy. Glad to be back with the Faster Data Insights with Power BI. Thanks for visiting the first part of our sessions, and I'm pretty sure you're going to like some of the recordings that you've seen. So let's have a look a little bit more on where we are in the agenda and what's coming up next. I've got a wonderful Sandy Rivas here with me that's going to talk about PowerView capabilities. Keep in mind that for the session itself, feel free to put feedback on Twitter. You got the necessary Twitter hashtags and the Microsoft Virtual Academy on there as well. Join the MVA community. We're doing so much more than just this Power BI Jumpstart. The MVA community is really your learning resource where you can learn about any Microsoft technology or product, and it actually uses a point-based system that's going to show you how well advanced you are with your learning through the Microsoft Virtual Academy. So you could use that link that you see there at the bottom, and also enter the Power BI code, so we can kind of keep track on how many of you joined the Power BI session actually for the first time. So we've had a busy agenda so far. We talked about the Power BI capabilities. Matt Mason showed us the great capabilities that we have with Power Query, followed up with Matthew Roach looking into the details. And right now, as I said, we have Sandy here that's going to drill down a bit more into how we get to the data visualizations within PowerView, which is available through Excel, and that's going to be the primary focus. Immediately after Sandy, we're going to have Ari coming in that's going to look into the visualizations using Power Map, and then we're going to look on how we're going to do the shared and collaboration, putting that out onto a Power BI site, look at the mobile BI opportunities, get into Q&A, and set up the data management gateway before we wrap up the end of our day. So with that and with no further delay, Sandy, welcome.
Yes.
It's great to have you here. You're just an amazing PM to work with and answer every potential question that I ever had on Power View. I do want to say that. How about you give us a little introduction on who you
sure.
are, and then we'll dive right in, right?
Sure, definitely. Well, my name is Sandy Rivas, and I am a program manager for PowerView. I've been with Microsoft for 14 years, and I started in the Office group working with Excel, Access, SharePoint, and I'm really a geek at heart. I just love data, and I love visualizing data, so being a program manager for PowerView, what I do is I drive features into the product and new capabilities based on customer feedback. And I'm also an avid user myself. So in essence, I have my dream job and I get paid to play. I love it. It's awesome.
That's just wonderful.
So what I want to talk to you today about is the visualized portion of the data analytics in Power BI. The visualized portion is PowerView. Now, what is PowerView? PowerView is an interactive data exploration, visualization, and presentation experience. That's it in a nutshell. Now, who uses PowerView? PowerView is great for power users or data analysts, but what I really love about it is that it's super simple for a typical office worker to use as well.
Can we focus a bit on that super simple? Because some of the feedback
yes.
that I got earlier this morning is, wow, this is really nice, some of the capabilities that you're showing us, but how do I get from, hey, here is my data, now let me build a PowerView report out of it. And then once I get that report, it's like, how do I format a report, those kind of things.
Exactly.
I think that's what you're going to be showing us
first, right?
That's
what I'm going to be covering today.
Yeah,
and that's a common problem, that people are challenged with using technology to understand their data to make business decisions. And that's where PowerView comes in, and it helps with that.
And there's a quick learning opportunity there, right? It's not like you're going to have to study 5 weeks to get to PowerView usage or whatever.
No, in fact, the scenario I'm going to show you today is exactly that scenario.
Awesome.
Where it's a brand new user who, it's actually a real case scenario of my brother who is technically challenged. For him, surfing the web and checking email pretty much maxes him out. So when you see what he could do with PowerView, anybody can do it.
So do you get that as well? Like when I travel to visit my family back in Belgium, that they asked me to fix their computer right away. So does your brother, your Columbus, Ohio?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Do they actually ask you every time you go there, hey, can you build me this PowerView?
Oh, I wish it was only when I went there. What happens is they have problems with other things, not PowerView, but just in the computer in general. So I have a standard account where I can just log into their computer and take control, because sometimes it's just too hard. But with PowerView, that's what's great, is he hasn't had challenges with that. Once I got him started, he's awesome with it.
So we're actually looking at a consumer of Power BI, Power BI user.
Yes.
What kind of business?
It is actually a retail operation, and it is a bar.
Oh,
but it's synonymous, and that's what I'm going to cover here. Is, in fact, in the next thing, is how do we use it? We use it in Excel, and the scenario that we're covering is retail sales that are collected via point-of-sale system. Now, point-of-sale systems are great for collecting information, but the reporting capabilities are really lacking because there's just no sales analysis in there. So for this scenario, it's about the bar, which is in Columbus, Ohio, as I mentioned, and my brother owns the bar. Now, it's synonymous with any type of retail operation because the data is set up that it's in a different hierarchy as far as category, subcategory, item, and then the employees execute transactions on the POS system. So that can be any type of retail operation. So while this is geared towards a bar, it is real data, and that's what we're working with. And our role today is we're going to play the role of the bar owner, who has limited technical capability. He wants to analyze his data to help him make business decisions and target promotions. And again, I want to remind you that this is a real scenario. It's real data from his bar, and the situations that we're going through are real things that we've actually done.
Perfect.
Okay?
Let's have a look.
Let's jump right in. Come on over here. Now, we're going to start in Excel. And what I want to show you really quick is about the data. We brought the data in through Power Pivot by connecting with SQL in the POS system. This is the format of the data. This is their actual data. You can see the category, types, and items. This is the hierarchy I was talking about. There's some supplemental tables to the items, which is the drink, ingredients, and recipes. The heart of everything, of course, is the transactions, and then we have employees and employee type. Now, you can imagine there's a lot more data that we could pull in, but we're going to focus on this particular data at this time. Let's actually take a look at the data real quick. These are recipes, there's drink ingredients. The main thing that we're going to focus on is the transactions. You can see we've done some calculated fields down here at the bottom. And we've also helped ourselves by creating some calculated fields off of the date. We have the basic date information, but for some analysis, we've created like the month name with simple formulas. And this is something that anyone can do. And we'll go into a little bit more detail in a bit. But for now, go ahead.
So earlier today, Matt Mason was showing us some of the capabilities on how we could use Power Query, connect to that database instance, automatically it will identify the fact tables and the dimension tables. This is kind of like the outcome of that when you go into the Power Pivot model. And so what you see on the bottom there is you actually just easily add some calculated members. But being able to get access to that data using Power Query is definitely one of the solutions that leads to that data model that you were showing in Power Pivot.
Definitely.
Right?
Yep. And I'm going to show you towards the end of my presentation, I'm going to show you how we actually use Power Query in a different way.
Oh, sounds good.
Okay?
Awesome.
Okay, so now that we're familiar a bit with the data, let's have some fun. Let's go over to Excel. And you can see that we're just on a plain sheet here, nothing fancy. We're going to insert Power View. Now, what this does is it creates a new type of visualization, a new canvas. This canvas has a visualization pane and a filter pane. It has a context-sensitive ribbon at the top, and over on the right-hand side is the field list and a field well, which is what you're probably familiar with in using with Excel. You can see in the field list we have all of our tables that we saw in Power Pivot. Let's focus on transactions. We're going to do some basic information here. And if we look at this, we can see that there's all of our different fields. Now, there's three different ways to add a field to the canvas. You can click it, you can drag it to the canvas, or you can drag it to the field well. I'll be using all three different methods. Let's start with something basic, like seeing our sales by year. So we're going to drop on year by checking it. I'm going to drag the sales over so you can see that. Now what it does is it creates a simple table for us because that's where we're used to seeing our data. But with the context sensitive ribbon at the top, we can choose what type of visualization we see. We're going to change this to a column chart. And that quick, you can see that it took our data and it put it in a visual manner that we can easily see that we did pretty good in 2012. We're kind of lacking in 2013. Now, as I hover over each chart, each column, it gives a tooltip. So it gives me the information that's behind that chart. Now, this is nice, but it's just a simple chart. Let's create another chart. Now, here's my favorite command, and you might want to write this down. You select the chart and you do Control C and Control V to paste.
Come on, that's copy paste.
I know, but it's a great command. Now, I have two charts here of the same thing. I don't want that. So what I can do is I can easily swap out one field for another. So if I come over to the field well, I'm going to move out the year and I'm going to move in the quarter. Now, I have two charts. Now watch what happens, Dandy, when I click on one. It automatically cross-highlights to the other. I didn't do anything else to hook it up. I just dropped two different charts on, and they automatically cross-highlight. If I click on the year, it shows me the relative quarter information, or if I click on the quarter, it gives me the relative year information. Now, this is great, and I don't really need the sales by year, so I'm going to customize these a little bit. I'm going to go up to the Layout menu, and I'm going to remove the title. So that gives me a little bit more space here. So this is great, and I want to get some more information. So I'm going to drop on another visualization. Now what I do is I click on the blank canvas, and you can see the difference when I'm on the canvas as opposed to when I have a chart selected. When the chart's selected, there's these little handles around it, and my mouse turns to a finger, which means that I can move and resize it. So I'm clicking on the blank canvas and I want to add some more information. I want to add weekday, sales, and date. Now this one I'm going to leave as a table, and you can see that I can sort the columns by clicking on the column title. I can also resize them. And I can reorder them by coming over to the field well on the right-hand side, and I move the date up. And I can change the sequence of the fields that way. I can resize this, move it over here. Now, what's really great is that all this works just perfectly with the cross highlighting that I already have. So if I click up here, you can see that not only is this chart cross highlighted, but the table is cross-filtered as well to the information that I highlight. So this is really helpful in analysis. Let's go a little farther. Let's add a year to this chart here. And we're going to drag the year onto the chart. And watch what happens. It created a clustered column, so it shows us the distribution of quarter information by year. I have this legend here, and the legend is also interactive. Notice as I click on the legend, everything cross-highlights accordingly. Okay. Now looking at this, we can see there's some information that we're going to want to explore a little bit deeper. We have the spike that's happening here. I'm going to resize this down a little bit so I get that out of the way. And my favorite command, copy, paste. I'm going to change this to a month chart. I'm going to move off the quarter, move on the month name. Now, I have legend here. I don't need legend duplicated because you can see it's the same information. So I can go to this chart, I go to the layout, and I simply remove the legend. Okay. Now, looking at this, you can see there's spikes and dips that we're going to want to explore. Some dips, for example, here in April 2009, that's when we first opened. August 2010, there was a special event that happened in Columbus. It was a one-time event. Sometimes there's recurring patterns that we want to explore. For example, in June, there's a recurring event in Columbus that we've learned to plan for, and we're doing pretty well with increasing our sales year over year. But we're going to want to explore a little bit deeper to see what's going on. Now, what I'm going to do is save us some time and some copy paste, and I'm going to put this in my easy bake oven and bring it out so that it's completed. You can see the structure and format here is the same. I'm going to go over to sales by period, and you see it's the same thing. The one thing I added here was data labels. That was simple to add by coming up to the layout, and I added data labels by just putting them on there. Okay. I changed the title to sales by period. Now, Dandy, I think these colors are really pretty, but my brother doesn't think they're quite masculine enough. So that's easy. We can change that. We go to the Power View tab and we come over to themes. And let's pick a more masculine theme. Okay, that looks a little better. And I can change the background. Now, that easy. I can customize this to the way that he wants to see it. Now that we have all the data here, let's explore a little bit further. Let's find out what's kind of happening on different areas. We talked about the spikes and dips, but let's focus on a particular area. For example, down the days of week. Mondays, you can see, are really low in sales. Mondays early on proved too much for people to go back to work and keep drinking. So we decide to close on Mondays. That's why the sales are so low. However, there are some sales, and that's because maybe special events or holidays that happen on Monday, we are open.
Or the ones staying late on Sunday night, maybe?
Well, we've actually set it up on so that we do close at 2:30 in the morning. So we've set it up, and we've done that so that those days are attributed to the previous day.
Yeah, perfect. And that's easy to do within the Power Pivot model.
Exactly, in Power Pivot. Mm-hmm. But Tuesdays is the next lowest day of the week. So that's something we're going to focus on now. And we want to see what we can do year over year to improve Tuesdays. So now what we're going to do is we're going to use the filter pane. And that's really easy to do by taking the year, dragging it, and dropping it on the filter pane. Now, you're going to see that there's three different types of cards that you can get on different types of data types. This is a slide range filter. So you can actually slide that down. The canvas reflects accordingly. This filters the entire canvas and it gives you a restatement of what the filter is. If we flip to another type, it's a list filter mode, and you can see that this is a categorical filter. So this can show us the actual results and we can pick a particular year if we wanted to. And we're going to pick 2011. Now, the next thing we want to do is we want to focus on the day because we talked about Tuesdays being low. Let's add the weekday as another filter. We're going to drag the weekday on and filter to Tuesdays. Now, looking at this, we can see, looking down here at the weeks, right away certain things stand out to me. Look at this dip right here. On week 6, if I click on that, I can see that that is February 1st, 2011. $311 in sales. That's not much. But what happened is that's in Ohio. They had a snowstorm and we closed early.
I figured.
Okay, yep. Mm-hmm. And they're all very familiar with that this year, too. The next lowest Tuesday of the year was in week 16. Let's look at that. 4/12. Dandy, what happens in April? Every year in the U.S., taxes.
Oh, of course.
Taxes are due on April 15th. Well, look at the sales there.
People don't drink on April 12th because of that?
Well, I think they're too depressed to do their, to file their taxes. Uh-huh. But look, the following week, sales almost doubled, so they recovered quickly or they decided to drown their sorrows.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I usually do my taxes on April 5th.
Oh, really? No. April 5th? Mm-hmm. So you'd be in good shape.
You see the
here.
Spike up there, right?
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. So, but this gave us insight as to a promotion that we could do for increasing sales on Tax Tuesday. The promotion we decided to do was Toast the Taxes. And this allows us to give people a reason to drink because people feel like they need a reason to drink. So we started this promotion. Let's see what happened. If we turn
off. We're not encouraging drinking, but we're like socializing,
no,
right?
We're socializing.
Perfect.
Yes. Oh. Yes. We're not encouraging drinking or alcohol consumption at all. We're just showing you factual information from a bar.
Socializing.
Socializing. Hmm. Yes. Let's look at 2012 and see what happened. Well, first of all, if we look at week 6, no repeat snowstorm. That's good. Let's go up to week 16. Wow, there's a huge spike here. Let's take a look. Well, that was actually after people filed their taxes. Let's look at the, because the week number, let's look at the Tuesday before they filed their taxes. $1,200. You remember the previous year was $600. So we doubled our sales just with that one promotion. So something like that gives us insight on what we can do to increase sales on targeted days or do targeted promotions. Now let's look at the highest Tuesday of the year here. If we look at that, oh, that's July 3rd. Well, that's my birthday, so of course everybody wants to celebrate that. Right, Dandy?
I guess, yeah.
Yeah, I'm sure you do. So the information we've seen here is that we've seen how we can analyze the information and target particular days or years by using the filter to understand what's happening in the history of the sales and target future sales. Now, when we set up the business, we decided that we had to have an annual average daily sales of $2,500 in order to maintain a successful business. So let's cover that scenario next. Now this is just a blank canvas, and let's see how we're doing on our average daily sales. We're gonna come over here and we're gonna say, show us the sales by year. Sales, we want to see by month name. We're looking for our average sales by week. So we'll get the weekday. And we have average sales up here. So looking at this, that's a lot of information. It's really hard to see how we're doing as far as averages, okay? So what we can do is kind of scroll through, look at it. That doesn't help much. But what is this all about? It's about visualization. So let's put something in that will allow us to visualize how we're doing on our average sales. We can do this simply by going to Power Pivot up at the top and create a KPI. Now, a KPI is a key performance indicator, and that gives us a visual clue as to where we're at. Let's create a new KPI. And again, this is going to be based off of the average sales. So we're going to change this to average sales here. And we want an absolute value, because remember, we have to have $2,500 in average daily sales. So I'm going to set this to 2,500. And if you look here, we've got these nice red, yellow, green indicators that tell us how close we are to the target. Now, we were really specific about having $2,500, so I'm going to increase this lower threshold, and I can do this by just dragging this up, take it up to 1,800. And the higher threshold, we're going to set to 2,250. And you saw that I can drag or I can type my value in. And we have different icons that we can use here. We're going to leave the default. That's all we need to do to create our KPI. I click OK, and watch what happens. Now it tells me that the data model has changed. That's because I went into Power Pivot and I added that KPI. So it's just a warning, there's nothing wrong. I click OK. It's applying these changes in Power View. And if we look over in transactions, we have this new field up here with the stoplight indicator. That is our KPI. If I expand that and I put the status over into this visualization, now I've got a great visual clue as to how I'm doing on my average daily sales. But that's still a lot of information to sort through. So let's see if we can reduce this down to make it a little bit more manageable. Well, one thing we can do is we can put a slicer on the canvas. A slicer is an on-canvas filter. I'm going to add the month name to the canvas. When you add a single column table, you will see that you have this opportunity to turn it into a slicer. This is similar to what you see in Excel. If I click on slicer, now I can just select any month and it will filter down to that month. That's still kind of hard for me to see how I'm doing on my average daily sales. So I'm going to focus on this table here. And I want to leave it at a table for right now, but I'm going to change it to a matrix. And watch what happens when I change this to a matrix. It reduces that information down. It actually reordered the fields for me in a logical order. Remember before, the sales was over here. It knows the hierarchy that we go from year to month to weekday. So that helps a lot for me to see how I'm doing on my average daily sales. But let's take it a step further. We're going to go to the show levels, and we're going to enable drill down one level at a time. And watch what this does. That collapses it all. I can resize this so that I can see. And now, where'd all my data go? Well, what happens is it's actually down under the information. If I click on a year, I can go down and I can see the information for that year. Now, how does it know to do this? Or how do I know what levels it's going through? Over in the field well, over here on the bottom right, you can see the different rows. So I can drill down year, month, weekday. I could put any kind of level of hierarchy in here that I want if I wanted to get to quarter or a week number. So I want to go down to the weekdays and see how we're doing in February. Well, that shows February overall, and it shows that we're not doing very well. If I scroll back up and I just click on those arrows to go back, what I can do here is using the slicer, I can click on a month and see how my average sales are for that month over all the years. So if I click on March, I can see, we're not doing too bad in March throughout the years. If I click on June, things are even better. Now, we have an outdoor patio for our bar, so that might contribute to the sales there. Let's click on February. And we can see that February in 2013, we didn't do so well. If we drill down into that, and we drill down into the days, we can see that we need a lot of help on Tuesdays through Thursday. We're closed on Mondays. Sometimes we have sales, but those are special events. So Tuesday through Thursday, we need to figure out what's going on, where those sales are coming from, and how we can increase promotions there. We're going to do that by creating a new visualization based on time period. So we're going to jump over to the time period blank canvas here. And here I'm going to drop on here the weekday because we're concerned about what's happening every day of the week. Once I drop the weekday on here, you'll see over here in the field well, I have this tile by. If I move the weekday up to the tile by, watch what happens. It creates a new type of visualization that has the weekdays up at the top. Now, remember how the slicer was a vertical slicer on the left. It filtered the entire canvas. What this slicer does is it slices everything that's within this subframe here. So let's go ahead and create a visualization in the subframe. We're going to add sales and time period. And we can see that we're going to change this to let's change it to a bar chart for something different. Okay. So we see our sales by time period there. Now, this is interesting, but I want a little bit more information to see how the sales are distributed between these different times. So I'm going to go up and I'm going to get my category field, and I'm going to add the category over here, and it adds a legend for the category. And that's great, but I kind of want to change that to a stacked chart. So I can come here, I change it to a stacked bar, and then it parses the information out by category. That's a start. Now what I want to do is I want to see what bartenders are selling during the different times. I can go to employees, and again, I just click on the blank part of the canvas. That's the indication that I'm going to create a new visualization. I'm going to drop on the employee first name, And then I'm going to go over to the transactions and I'm going to drop on the sales. And I'm going to change this one to a column chart. Resize this. Okay. Now, one more piece of information is I want to see a little bit of detail on when these sales are actually taking place. So I'm going to drop on the date and time in its own table over here. Okay, now that's a lot of information that it put out there. And that's kind of hard for me to analyze. So what did we learn before? We learned about using a slicer to filter down. I'm going to put a slicer on here, and then we're going to start doing our analysis. So I am going to slice by time period. Change it to a slicer. Now, I've got all the key pieces of information I need to make some analysis here. Well, first of all, I want to see by our employees who's doing the best. I can sort charts by coming up here where it says sort by. I can change that to a different field. It'll drop down and I can say sort by sales. And what it does is it'll sort it by sales in ascending order. So I can see who's not doing so well and who's doing better. I can also sort by descending and focus that way. Now, notice what I can do here is I can see on Sundays. I can click on Tuesdays and see what's happening on Tuesday. I can click on Wednesday. And the information here is changing accordingly. Now, this is interesting, but something that's really important for us to know is why are there sales after we're closed? I use the slicer over here to click on this closed slice, and that filters the entire canvas. And this is concerning because it's showing that there's sales of alcohol after we're closed. That's a violation of our liquor license, and that could actually get our liquor license revoked. So knowing this information, I can go down and I can find out which bartenders are selling after we're closed and figure out what's going on. Because that is something that we absolutely cannot tolerate is having sales after we're closed. And as we look through here, we can see that there's different, sometimes non-alcoholic. Non-alcoholic is okay, but the liquor and the beer cannot happen after we're closed. So these are important decision-making information for us to monitor the health of our business and not risk our liquor license as well. Now that's been a lot of information on the analysis of the data that we have. The next thing I want to cover is data that we don't have. You learned earlier about Power Query. What we want to do is we want to pull in some outside data that will help influence maybe some actions that we can take. So we're going to go up to Power Query. And you can do an online search. And let's say if we wanted to see Columbus, Ohio. And we searched. We can see different information out here. And as we hover over, we can see what might be relevant to us. Historical population, demographics, that could be interesting. Climate data for Columbus, that's interesting too, because remember we have a patio bar. So does the temperature have a correlated effect to our sales? That's something that we could pull in and pull that information and analyze that.
So I think if you look at something like this, and I really want to stress on that, I mean, look at the opportunity you have here now, right? Mm-hmm. I have a point of sale system. I can find out on, hey, what's going on with my sales? I can see certain dips and certain spikes and then bring in that external data set and then
influence decisions
based on that.
Definitely.
And I would assume it goes into staffing, like how many people do I need, how busy it's going to be.
Yep. And we know if really the weather's bad.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, that is quite impressive.
Yeah.
And so what we see here on the Power Query side is we're actually just using data from that public data catalog, which in this case is coming from a Wikipedia publication.
Right.
So we index that, put that into the public catalog, and now we're going to consume that as part of Power View. And I think that's just a great opportunity being able to get those kind of insights.
But we're going to do something even more fun, because I'm not content with this. I want to pull more information. We're going to go to Power Query. Now, we can pull it from the web, because what I want to do is I want to see how are my competitors doing in Columbus. And there's a website called Yelp.com. You've heard of that.
Uh-huh.
They go out there. It's a consumer review website. So we can actually give the URL to pull that down, or we can pull it from file. Now, to save time, I put it into a file previously. So I'm going to go pull it from Excel. And here's my Yelp data. We're going to pull this in through Power Query. And we have the Yelp data here that we can see. Yes, that's what we want.
So basically what you did here is the Yelp workbook is data that you pulled in from Yelp using Power Query again,
yes.
Right?
Yes. Yes. Okay. And I just pulled it down so it'd be faster and we don't have to worry about internet connections here.
Yep.
So if I click on that, I now have the opportunity to load this information or edit it. I want to edit it first. So I click on edit, and here's the data. Well, first of all, we can see that I want to change the column names to the first row. I can click up here, use first row as headers. Okay. Now, if I look through here, I can see, oh, we have a ratings here. I want to make sure that that's a numeric field because I'm going to do a calculation with this. So if I right click, I can change the type to number. And we see the rest of the information that we have. I think that's all we need to do. I'm going to come down here. I don't want to load it to a worksheet. I want to just go ahead and load it right to the data model. I come up to the top. I say apply and close. You can see it's loading. And it's almost loaded. And now what I'm going to do is go into Power Pivot and work with this data a little bit. So if we click on Power Pivot, Manage, it says the model's changed. That's okay. Because what happened is it saw that Power Pivot, that the Yelp data came in. You see there it is right there. Let's go manage that real quick. Here's the Yelp data. Now there's a couple things I want to do here that are going to help me. First of all, I want to change this address. If I take a look here, there's a data category in the advanced column that right now it says uncategorized. If I change that to an address, that sets it to a category of address. And I'm going to show you later why that's important. Sometimes it will automatically detect what the field type is. If we look here at the link, we'll see a web URL. They suggested that, and that's correct. We want to leave that. Here we have an image URL. But I left it as a generic path because I wasn't exactly sure where I would put it on this hard drive. So what I can do is I can make a calculated column by clicking equals C colon an ampersand and then concatenate this column with that. Hit enter. And you'll see that calculated this column automatically for us. It just put those two pieces of information together. I'm going to rename this column to change it to picture. Okay. Now remember we had the different types, the data categories. This I want to categorize as an image URL. Now this image URL could actually go up to the web, but again, in the interest of time, I'm just keeping it local. One more thing we want to do is set the table behaviors here. If I go to table behavior, I want to identify what is the row identifier. That's name. I want a default label of name, and I'm going to show you specifically why this is important later, and the default image of picture. I'm going to save that. And the last thing I want to do is I want to create a KPI based on our ratings. So I'm going to come over here and I'm going to say that I want an average calculation on this. So now we have average here. I want to change the title of this just to make it a little bit shorter. So we have our average of ratings, but I want to create a KPI. And I can do that right from Power Pivot here. Click on Create KPI. Now my absolute value is, it's on a rating scale of 1 through 5. So my absolute value, my target is 5. Again, we're pretty conservative with our threshold, so I'm going to make my lower threshold of 2.5 and my upper threshold of 4.5. And just for fun, we're going to change the icon type. Click OK. And I think that's all we need to do here. We're going to minimize this. We're going to go back to Power View. We see the data model's changed. That's great. We can close out this workbook queries. We don't need that right now. And let's go to our comp analysis, which is a blank page. Here's our Yelp data. Let's go ahead and get this information on here. We have our name. Look at this little icon here next to it. Remember when we set that default table behavior? We said that the name was an identifier. So I'm going to click the name. And I'm going to click the rating and the picture. Now, it says references to external pictures have been blocked. That's okay. It's just a precautionary. Now, it puts all this information here, but that's kind of, you know, hard to see like that. But as default, it creates it into a table. We're going to change this to a new visualization type of a card. Now, look what happens. Is it creates this information, and it made these names nice and big. That's because we set it as the identifier, okay? Let's add some more information here. We want our KPI. We're going to come here. We're going to drop the status on there so we can see that little visual. And we're also going to put the link on here. Okay. Now, the next thing we want to do is we want to see where these businesses are located, because they're our competitors. We want to see where they're located at. Let's create a new visual with address, and let's put the rating on here too. Oops, the value. Now watch what we can do. Here's another visual, a map. Look at that. It zoomed in and it mapped every one of those places. Now this is great, but let's add a little bit more color to this, and we're going to drop the ratings down in the color. Okay. Now, I am very interactive with this map, just like all the different visuals. I can click on a legend and I can have everything filter to that. I can click on a bubble and have it filter. I can sort this by ratings. Let's say I want to sort this in and see what our highest competitors are. Now this is great, but I might want to get a little bit more information because we want to go spy on these competitors and see what makes them so good. With this URL, we can control click and it actually goes out to that Yelp review of that same bar. Okay, so that's a great way for you to interact with your data and pull in outside external information that will help you in analyzing your business and making business decisions. We've covered a lot, Dandy.
This is great. I mean, I'm actually, one of the things that I struggled with is like, okay, I see all these nice visualizations in Power View, and then I wonder like, how long is it going to take me to actually build that? And you just built report after report and brought in visualizations in like less than 30 minutes. And I think that by itself is just stunning.
Yeah.
Being able to do that within Excel, just have that Power View sitting there. And then when we look at it from a sharing and collaboration perspective, and then we have a session coming up later with Alex Kelly where we're going to take those workbooks and put them onto a Power BI site, I think that that's just quite impressive. I mean, I assume that you have this rolled into a Power BI site. And
Exactly, you know, because while my brother owns the bar in Columbus, we also have investors who are in New York. they don't have Excel 2013 yet. So what we do is we put it up on a Power BI site. They don't have to have Excel 2013. They log into the site and they can interact with this report the exact same way.
Just using the browser.
Mm-hmm. Right. And you saw how quick this was to create. And it's literally drag and drop. Some of it's a little bit of trial and error, see how things you like. But that's, to me, that's part of the fun. You get to play with it and see what happens when I do this and what happens when
I do that. Now, one of the things you mentioned, this is, could you go back to the report?
Sure. Which one?
Just any.
Yep.
So let's take, just any. This one is okay. You mentioned the different teams and the different styles you could apply to report there, right?
Mm-hmm.
One of the things that I've actually seen and kind of provide us, like, hey, have you thought about this, is that option where you can actually set image.
Yes.
So with the set image, you can set a background image, right?
Absolutely.
And so what I've seen is some really amazing, stunning visualizations mm-hmm. by someone that would first go into PowerPoint and actually lay out a background image with some gradients and additional fonts and logos and so on, and then save that mm-hmm. as a JPEG image or a PNG file to use as a background in a Power View report.
Right.
So
there's actually another visualization that I've done here that's already completed. Oh, that's not it. Let me show you sales by type. That's not it either. You see, I have a whole bunch of visualizations here. But there's another visualization that has the sales that you can add images to the tile.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And then filter based on the tiles and the...
Exactly.
We got some examples on that.
Uh-huh. So we've covered a lot of information here. Let's go recap what we've actually done here, because we're running short on time, and I could literally go on all day long about this.
I wish you could as well.
I wish I could too, because it's like so much fun. So if I could find my mouse here, resume slideshow. Okay. Here we are. Okay. So let's recap what we've covered. We have covered the ease of going from a blank canvas to visual insights. We've covered creating a variety of visualizations, utilized a number of features in our exploration. We've used Power Query to pull in external data. And we interacted with the visuals to direct business decisions. And what we didn't cover, but actually happens, is the workbook with Power View and full interaction can be shared via Office 365. Mm-hmm. So that's what we've covered. Let's find out what the results are. The actual result is that we have a business owner who is empowered to understand his data and make decisions based on his interactive data exploration, visualization, and presentation experience with Power View.
So one of the questions that came up on the forum was someone was asking like, oh, wow, you got this Power View report, and we should follow up with that person in private mm-hmm. Because they're more interested in, hey, like, what kind of point of sale system were you using? How
yes.
difficult was to bring that data in and then get mm-hmm. that data into visualizations? So what I actually, I sent a message to that person to follow up directly with me and you on that.
Sure. And it was a point of sale system that was SQL based, so it was really easy. The hardest part was in point of sale systems, they have a lot of additional fields that mm-hmm. aren't necessarily important to us. Yep. So the hardest part was just identifying which were the key fields that we wanted. But once we had it, it was easy and we refresh regularly.
Okay, but it's SQL based.
Yeah, definitely. Okay. It's SQL based.
Perfect. Uh-huh. Okay, with that, we're going to take a 10-minute break, and then we're going to have Ari Shore coming up. That's going to talk to us about the Power Map visualization that we have as part of our Power BI offering. Mm-hmm. Sandy, thank you so much.
This was
so useful. I learned so much out of this myself with the drill down capabilities and so mm-hmm. on. So really, thanks for your time.
You're welcome. It's my pleasure.
See you soon, everyone.